For most of human history, winter has been our most bitter adversary. Our ancestors faced brutal months of terrible cold, and the constant anxiety that food and fuel would last until the thaw. This heroic battle of endurance was ignored by artists, who saw nothing to paint in this harshest of seasons. But once we were able to protect ourselves from the worst the weather could do, we began to look at winter in a new way, to appreciate its transient beauty, its seasonal variety, and its terrible power. Winter began to inspire images that are now amongst the most popular paintings of all time. The struggle for survival in a Flemish village, a temporary terra firma on the frozen Thames, the most remarkable outflanking maneuver in the history of war. The more we understood the power of winter, the more we used art to explore our fascination with its effect on our lives. As our confidence grew, we developed a rational disregard for the cold and learned to love the things that had previously scared us. But when winter occasionally reasserts its authority, we can still experience the terror our forebears knew. Across Northern Europe, the winter of 1564 was the coldest of the century. Crops failed, and towns and cities were plagued with famine and riots. A deep and prolonged frost left many dying from starvation and hypothermia. This terrible period of cold was the first great winter of the Little Ice Age.
By the time we get into the 16th century, they're set in what has become known as the Little Ice Age. It's a very traumatic period for an agricultural society, and it's not until the 1800s that we start to warm up again. The winters were terrible. This winter of 1564-5 saw the largest snowfalls that had been experienced in a generation.
Nowhere were the effects of this vicious winter more keenly felt than in the Netherlands, where political turmoil and religious strife caused by the Spanish occupation added to the misery. But another revolution was taking place that winter in the studio of a Flemish painter in Brussels. Pieter Bruegel was painting the first snowscape in art, Hunters in the Snow.
Hunters in the Snow is one of the most original paintings of all time. It's an incredible, almost a seismic shift in the world of art. Just forgetting about the snow for a moment, it's actually one of the first great landscapes. I mean, Bruegel has this trick of conveying immense amounts of territory and expressing the world itself, a sense of being on a planet. This is what Earth is like in winter.
This picture, you know, it's one of the most famous landscape paintings in the world. Sort of asked myself as an artist, why it is so iconic? You know, why has it sort of seared itself into the public imagination? We look at the hunters and their sort of slumped poses and the way the dogs' heads are all kind of drooping down towards the snow. You know, we immediately sort of get feelings of abjection, and you're taken into that late afternoon. You know, oh my, for me it's like, oh God, there's school tomorrow. It's an awfully depressing thing. But then in the background it's sort of lightning. Oh, all the people are having fun. It's nice, they're all skating on the ice. It's not a kind of uniformly pessimistic painting.
Bruegel was one of the few Northern European painters who had travelled to Italy at this time. But it wasn't the great works of the Renaissance that influenced his pictures. It was the snowy landscape he had crossed on his journey.
It's a made-up landscape. I mean, here we have the architecture and the people of Flanders juxtaposed with the Alps. You know, it doesn't exist, this scene. The Alps were like the moon to people who lived in the Low Countries in this period.
In the Renaissance, nobody thought of painting a winter's day. The sky should be blue. The atmosphere should be warm. That was what was beautiful. So winter was really a new idea in art. Snow is beautiful as well. It seems obvious to us now because it has been depicted in art for so long. But it was something that had to be invented, discovered, thought about.
He's used the snow totally in the way that an art gallery works against the back of a painting. It's a stark nothingness against which life moves. That's why it works. You know, there's no different tones of snow. It's all crisp white. There's no melting going on here. This is your perfect fantasy of a snowy day. And there is an element of truth about that. If you're out in the landscape in the snow, it always has a sort of fluorescent glow to it that kind of comes up from the ground and it bleaches out all the shadows like a slightly sort of overexposed photograph. I mean, there are the footprints of the hunters, but yeah, it's a pretty pristine scene. It is fairyland.
Bruegel was one of the first painters whose work had overtly social and political messages, and this has made his pictures easily adaptable for parody. Hunters in the Snow remains immensely popular with political cartoonists.
Most people know the title of the painting, so they know what the context is that you're putting your political figures in. And so I subvert it, really. And it has to have a theme, if you like. And the one I did for The Spectator Christmas last year was based on the Eurozone and how that was collapsing. It's quite a depressing painting in a strange way. The colours are very muted and green, green-grey. And one of the great joys of parodying it is the fact that snow is obviously white. And what you're leaving is the whiteness of the paper. And that's terrific. I mean, I'll just show basically how it's done. So I have several trees. I think there are four or five trees in the painting. Trees were the nicest thing to draw, actually, in a strange way. But where the trees end, you've got this lovely sort of absence of anything, which is what the snow is. And just by leaving areas completely white and empty, you're creating something that's physically there and you're making a picture out of it. He was just good at making it look bloody cold.
Hunters in the Snow was an immediate hit for Bruegel. He had connected with something elemental about the experience of winter that we can still find in the picture today.
The picture actually captures a very kind of primal scene, one that is in some way hardwired into our perception of the seasonal. Maybe that's why it kind of keys in so strongly to those of us who experience a winter. To this day, I cannot come over the snowy brow of a hill without thinking of that image. It's so intrinsic to the way that I perceive the juxtaposition between the cold outdoors and the warm inside. These elements seem to me to speak of a kind of deep atavistic human need for security, for shelter, and also a kind of delight to the eye in wandering between the evocations of cold and winter in the foreground. And then, although of course it's very snowy in the midground, there is the suggestion everywhere that there will be warmth down there around the churchyard and around the hamlet and in the village. You know, even if we're in with the hunters in the snow for a minute, there's a kind of, you know, Potterton boiler just down here.
We have to ask, why does the winter landscape gradually become a thing we can appreciate as beautiful, a thing that we can enjoy. And of course we can enjoy winter landscapes today because we can go back indoors and put the central heating on. So it's rather fascinating to look back and wonder at what points people have felt comfortable enough, have had a good enough quality of life, enough food and firewood, to be able to go outside into the cold and enjoy it.
The position that the viewer occupies is sort of slightly up and behind the hunters. You're actually in the kind of position you're in nowadays in computer gaming when you pull back behind the head of an avatar. We're in a highly cinematic position to see the development of where the hunters are going to go. And ineluctably, you want to go with the hunters. Quite clearly, you're with the hunters. You want to seek that warmth.
The painting perfectly captured a universally shared emotional response to the experience of winter and showed that this darkest time of year could make a powerful subject for art. No one seemed more pleased with this discovery than Bruegel himself. There is evidence he may even have gone back and added snow to paintings he had already finished. Bruegel was also a pioneer in another sense. Though there is no mention in the Bible of the time of year when Jesus was born, the Christian Church had established the festival of the Nativity in the depths of winter. Bruegel was the first person to take this literally and set the events of the Christmas story in the snow, giving them a dramatic new realism for people who were experiencing exactly the conditions they saw in his paintings.
Perhaps his most shocking scene is the Massacre of the Innocents. He was working in a time when there was war in Flanders. The Spanish army were engaged in quite severe reprisals, and he sets it not in ancient times, but in his own time, in a village, in a sort of village high street, and soldiers are coming down the street. Not Roman soldiers, they're Spanish soldiers, and it's terrifying.
It's a bit like kind of nowadays they might set a Shakespeare play in Iraq. This painting is very political in that it's setting a very brutal biblical scene. I mean, probably one of the most brutal, the Massacre of the Innocents. And he's using that to get at the Spanish invaders. And here, Bruegel has painted it in the snow, emphasising the time of year, but also the kind of abject misery of the scene. The brutality and harshness is made all the more stark against the white background of the snow.
In Bruegel's darkest paintings, the cruelty of winter is an image of the harshness of mortal life. It's merciless, and it's an image of the unrelenting nature of winter, and perhaps by extension of the unrelenting nature of war.
The cruel snow of Bruegel's massacre was a reflection of the time in which he lived. The extreme cold of the Little Ice Age set in for the next 250 years. But these bitter winters could sometimes provide opportunities for amusement. The change in the climate was keenly felt in Britain too, most famously causing the Thames to freeze over more regularly. In 1621, as a consequence, the Lord Mayor licensed more butchers to compensate for the scarcity of fish. But the cold was not the only thing that contributed to this phenomenon. The way that Old London Bridge was built was also a factor. This view of the river in 1677 was painted by Abraham Hondius, a Dutchman who had recently moved to London.
The Old London Bridge has lots and lots of little arches, and these are big platforms in between which block the flow of the river. As soon as you had a few blocks of ice in the river, they'd nudge up against the piers, get trapped, and before you know it, the whole area to either side of London Bridge was frozen solid.
Hondius has painted a confident Dutchman on skates amongst the revelers. He would have been very familiar with the frozen dikes and canals of Holland, but his Londoners are astonished by this alien environment.
The British are not used to this. They're clambering and falling all over the place. I think there's a way in which Hondius is having a laugh at them. These are grown men turned into children again. He gives chaps like this a sort of heroic position, clambering on top of the ice floes here. The river has frozen right from the bridge up to Southwark Cathedral, which we can see just over there, which at that point dominated the skyline. But it's not a flat surface at all. We've got these shards and splinters of ice. The foemen were out of work because they couldn't ply their trade across the water. And so they rather proprietorially decided that they could charge people to come down onto the ice and then charge them again to leave the ice the other side. So people queued up. You can see them queuing to come down the steps here. And chap here being told to reach into his pocket for coins. But it was clearly worth paying your few coins because this was like some kind of theme park. Hondius was very interested in the ways in which we imagine remote and extreme places. And in this same year, 1677, he painted what he called an Arctic adventure, which actually looks very similar to this in that he imagines this barren, ice-clad landscape. So actually he's making the centre of London into a version of the Arctic.
5 years later, the Arctic conditions returned. In 1683, Britain suffered what may have been the coldest winter of the Little Ice Age. Once again, the Thames froze, but on this occasion, the stillness of the air and the abrupt and dramatic drop in temperature left the river with a surface as smooth as glass. This virgin real estate was quickly colonized by entrepreneurial Londoners, who created a winter wonderland of epic proportions without paying a penny in rent for their premises.
We're just in the right spot here. We can see Temple straight ahead, and this whole area became known as Temple Street because it was actually a street. There were carriages crossing the river at this point. There were people queuing, thousands of people flocking down onto the Thames to see this spectacle. And hundreds of little booths selling anything that you wanted on the ice.
There was an unwritten but widely respected feeling that this temporary terra firma was somehow not part of the realm and not subject to the normal laws of the land. The huge crowds attracted by the spectacle contained an uneasy mix of all classes, and the courtesies of society were not respected. The king brought the royal family down to see what all the fuss was about and left with this commemorative card recording his attendance.
And I suppose the whole obsession with souvenirs was really the sense that this absolutely transitory carnival would vanish overnight, absolutely just vanish. This city on ice, it really is a whole city, isn't it? Would be gone in an instant.
The sense that the punters at the Frost Fair were living on borrowed time subsided as the cold continued. The river was frozen for 10 weeks, and this enforced holiday had a devastating effect on the economy of the city.
The fact that the Thames froze over almost brought the city to a standstill. And what do you do if you're forced to have a holiday in England? You go and put on a carnival like this.
London's frost fairs demonstrated our ability to adapt to anything the weather could throw at us and have a good time in the process. In the 19th century, the medieval London Bridge was rebuilt, the river embanked, and the ice never returned. Londoners may have lost their opportunity for a midwinter party, but we were not alone in challenging the elements by having fun at the coldest time of the year. The Catholic Church adroitly adapted ancient seasonal rituals to its own ends, and before the austerity of Lent, Revelers had traditionally celebrated their last chance for feasting and excess in the depths of winter with a carnival. Nowhere was this tradition more indulgently embraced than in the serene Republic of Venice. This picture by Francesco Guardi, painted in the 1780s, shows the celebrations on Giovedì Grasso, the Thursday before Lent.
Well, what's so fantastic about this picture is the atmosphere, really. There's just this sort of extraordinary sense of a party going on, which I really, really like. I think there are lots of reasons for the carnival. Fundamentally, it was about surviving this long, often really bitterly cold winter. It's saying winter's okay, winter can actually be fun. And it's also about what Venice is. It kind of establishes a great sense of collective solidarity between all the different people who lived in Venice.
As a good Venetian, Guardi was reflecting this solidarity in one crucial respect. No one in his painting looks ready to admit that it was too cold to be behaving like this.
I don't know what time Easter was that year, but it's on the Thursday, Giovedì Grasso, and we're here on a Saturday. And 2 days later, in other words, and all I can say is that it's seriously freezing cold, because they all look quite relaxed. And actually the woman in the front, you know, she's in a state of slight undress. And of course, during the carnival in Venice, that would actually be quite difficult, because what the picture doesn't show us is how incredibly cold it can be in the winter in Venice. The wind seems as though it's coming straight from Russia.
Francesco Guardi was a vegetista, a Venetian view painter, a few years younger than Canaletto, but he outlived his more famous rival by 25 years.
I prefer Guardi to Canaletto because he really does capture a kind of sense of the movement and people of Venice. In Canaletto, it's all about order and kind of Venice as it ought to be. Whereas in this painting, you've got Venice as it really is, and it's all about people having a great time.
Guardi didn't know it, but his picture showed the Doge presiding over one of the last carnivals. 4 years after his death, in 1797, Napoleon invaded northern Italy and brought an end to 1,000 years of the Republic. The defeated Venetians stopped celebrating the carnival at the same time.
The carnival was only revived in the 1970s, really for commercial reasons. It was to bring tourists into the city in February, when normally it was a very low season. There is still quite a lot about it that we can recognise. There's a temporary structure over there in Piazza San Marco, just like the temporary structure in Guardi's painting. And also a whole kind of atmosphere of dance and chaos and movement. I mean, you look at the acrobats and it looks as though they're actually just about to fall over. Although it is more commercial, you look around you and people are really having fun. People are wearing masks. People are really getting together and having a party. The joy, the sheer joy, despite the freezing cold, of being in Venice for an event like this. And I think in that respect, there are really a lot of similarities between this painting and what we're seeing going on around us today.
Venice became a political bargaining chip in Napoleon's European wars and began a long period of decline. But centuries of indolence and extravagance had fitted her quite well for her new role as a tourist curiosity. Celebrating in winter didn't have to be such an ostentatious affair, though. The city of Edinburgh could certainly match Venice when it came to cold weather, But the new rational sensibilities of the Scottish Enlightenment led to more reserved ways to have fun in the cold. Since the union with England in 1707, Scotland had steadily increased in material prosperity. But it was in the fields of science and the arts that a new confidence was most evident. An English visitor famously claimed to be able to stand at the cross in Edinburgh and take 50 men of genius and learning by the hand. Had he done so, it's a safe bet that many of them would have recently had their portrait painted by Sir Henry Raeburn. In the 1790s, amusing themselves away from their books, several of these men of learning established the Edinburgh Figure Skating Club and met at the Sheephead Inn in Duddingston. In the depths of winter, when the cold weather froze the nearby loch, their leading light, the Reverend Robert Walker, took to the ice.
I think the Reverend Walker's right in front of us, because there you're going up the back of Arthur's Seat and then over to Duddingston Village. You've got the gentle hills moving down. You can't see any of the houses of Duddingston Village. But I think he was being observed by Raeburn roughly from where we are now. The sky is that icy, watery grey blue of a Scottish winter. And I remember days like that because as a child, you know, we went skating in the lochs all the time, so it must have been colder. Also in Scotland, people were very stoic in the winter. Winters were long and hard and dark. And look, here he is making the most of it. If you look at the way Raeburn has done the cuts in the ice, there's lots of gliding movement, there's lots of circular movements. The Reverend Walker has been skating around for quite a while here. And I don't think Raeburn obviously painted this oil painting on the water, but he certainly took the sketches for it. And he made sure that he showed that the Reverend Walker had had to work for his portrait for quite a long time.
Presbyterianism, the strict Protestant doctrine of the Church of Scotland, greatly approved of Stoicism. But in many other respects, it was an institution seemingly at odds with the rational and humanist ideals of the Enlightenment.
Presbyterianism is regarded as being incredibly dour, but actually, this is not a pompous picture of a minister of the Kirk saying, look at me, I can skate so beautifully on the loch, you know, I've been skating all my life. This is a minister who says, let's have a bit of fun. Look, he looks like a dandy. It's almost camp. He's got this beautiful frock coat on, and this lovely hat, and this white tied shirt at the neck. And he's got a slight smile on his face, which is what I love about it. A lot of the clergy were involved with the literati of the Scottish Enlightenment, and liked the conversation about science and the natural world, geology, geography. In Edinburgh, in this tiny area, you could just feel their brains sizzling. This is my favourite Scottish painting. This is my absolute favourite Scottish painting. This, to me, is what Scotland's all about.
One of the great changes in the 18th century was homes have barometers in them. It's something that ordinary people start doing. It's tapping their barometers to see whether today is changeable to fair. People have thermometers, and so where Bruegel couldn't measure how cold his snowy scene was, it was only measurable in terms of what he felt on his skin. But for the 18th century artist, this is a very particular kind of cold. This is however many degrees below zero. So when we talk now about the coldest winter since records began, we're really looking back to this time in the 18th century where it occurred to people to start measuring.
The casual grace of the skating minister, apparently immune to the bite of the Scottish winter, reflected a general lack of concern in these enlightened times for the threat from the weather. Protected in their modern houses in the terraces of Edinburgh's New Town, it seemed science and rational thought could solve all the problems that beset their superstitious ancestors. Winter was merely a natural consequence of the rotation of the earth and held no fear for men of learning. But the hubris of the Scottish Enlightenment's attitude to the weather was nothing compared to that of the newly appointed First Consul of France. Napoleon Bonaparte was confident he could conquer winter as a first step on his way to conquering the world. The Great St. Bernard Pass, crossing the Alps between France and northern Italy, was the scene of one of the most successful surprises in military history. Even today, the road through the pass is only open in the summer, but in the winter of 1800, Napoleon marched his army through these mountains. This extraordinary feat was painted by the French revolutionary enthusiast Jacques-Louis David. His dramatic and inspirational portrait was designed to put Napoleon up there with the greatest generals of all time.
In the pantheon of military greats, there's a special place reserved for those who have campaigned in winter. It's the ultimate challenge. I mean, look at this painting. It's the apotheosis of heroic leadership. He looks calm, collected, the windswept hair, his mighty stallion rearing in the air, his finger pointed towards Italy and his enemies. This is the foundation myth of Napoleon as a warrior leader of the French people.
Napoleon's goal was the reconquest of northern Italy, and his enemies, the Austrians, were waiting for him in Genoa, confidently looking west along the coast for a French invasion. By taking a shortcut across the Alps, Napoleon arrived unexpectedly at their rear and won a great victory at the Battle of Marengo.
The most remarkable thing about this is that David never saw this pass. Napoleon never even sat for this portrait. He simply said he wished to be painted calm sur un cheval fougueux. Calm on a fiery steed. And that's exactly what David has done for him here.
David was a believer. He was a political believer. He believed in the French Revolution. And I think when he painted this, he believed in Napoleon. This is a vision of Napoleon as more God than man. One thing about David, he's not a landscape artist. He is only interested in the crossing of the Alps as metaphor, as a historical image. So nature is only there to set off the man.
50 years later, when another Frenchman, Paul de la Roche, painted the same event, the metaphor was gone. The only thing his far more historically accurate picture had in common with David's version was Napoleon's hat.
De la Roche produces a very, very different painting, but one, in fact, that is just as heroic because it's a far more realistic impression of the incredible odds that Napoleon had to overcome in order to get his army across this path. We see not a mighty stallion, but a mule pressed into service from a local village. The men behind him had their hats couched down, trying to keep the wind from blowing them off. Napoleon's breeches are mud spattered. He's wearing his campaigning greatcoat, huddled against the cold. And he has a guide here, a peasant guide, leading him. The mighty First Consul of France in the hands of a Swiss peasant. Whichever version you buy into, what both these paintings do is provide evidence of the enduring obsession with people for Napoleon Bonaparte. Very embarrassingly, as a teenage boy, I had this painting on the wall of my bedroom, just as I was developing a great love of military history. And whatever you thought about Napoleon Bonaparte as a man, as a general, as a force of nature, he's one of the most exceptional commanders who has ever lived.
It seemed perfectly reasonable of the Austrians to have ignored the possibility that Napoleon would arrive this way. The challenge of taking an army over this pass was unimaginable. At nearly 10,000 feet, the thin air makes every footstep an effort. At the very top of the pass is the hospice of Saint Bernard. They say there's no such thing as a free lunch, but no one told Napoleon.
The religious community up here have been providing life-saving hospitality for centuries, but I doubt they ever had a more
demanding guest than Napoleon Bonaparte. Now, Napoleon was famous for saying an army would march on its stomach. He was a famous logistician. And while they were here, they consumed 22,000 bottles of wine, a ton and a half of cheese, and nearly a ton of meat. But he was also famous for being quite rapacious. He didn't tend to pay the bills that much, and he certainly never paid the bill up here. But eventually, the monks got their own back. François Mitterrand, the president of France, visited this wonderful monastery in the 1980s, and he finally, after about 200 years, paid the bill.
Napoleon's achievement continued to inspire painters, becoming even more celebrated in the late 19th century. Outside, in front of the hospice, Édouard Castres painted this scene of the passage of Napoleon's soldiers.
I'm looking down on Italy, and behind me, several hundred miles, is Paris. If you draw a line from Paris where Napoleon was to the Austrian army in northern Italy, you come through here. Standing up here on the top of the world, he must have thought he had winter licked. He was a commander like no other. But 12 years later, it turned out he was mere mortal after all. He invaded Russia without the necessary supplies and winter clothing, and 500,000 of his men died. In the end, winter got its own back.
In the years following his remarkable feat in this pass, Napoleon seemed invincible, a situation that led to a great deal of soul-searching in the nations he defeated. In Dresden, the work of the romantic landscape painter Caspar David Friedrich reflected this brooding, somber mood.
Caspar Friedrich is born at a very interesting time in German history. On October 14th, 1806, Napoleon had crushed the Prussian army at Jena-Auerstedt, and the Prussian army was considered the greatest professional army at the time in Europe. So this caused a real crisis in the way Germans and the German nations thought about themselves. They'd been defeated in the war, and they really felt, well, who are we, what are we, where are we going? We've got to reconstruct ourselves. Essentially, what they find in this dark, wounded space is the Gothic sensibility. You might find vampires, you might find ruins, graveyards, areas which represent melancholy, represent the sublime, represent terror, represent fear, represent anxiety. These are the areas that are really becoming more interesting to romantic writers and painters. The picture itself is a fairly grim image. Winter is obviously very bleak, everything's dead, and we have in the forefront the snow-covered ground, a landscape of monks, of burial, and out of that comes these almost fingers or skeletal trees grasping at the light which is coming from the sky. And at the top we see this little circle of the moon, which is suggestive of the redemptive force of Christianity.
The Christian message of Friedrich's picture is not immediately evident. The ruined Gothic tracery and bleak winter setting offer little comfort to a believer. But Friedrich's Northern European Protestant faith led him to explore new ways to paint the experience of divinity in a secular world.
I think it is radical, actually. I think it would have been really startling for people looking at this at the beginning of the 19th century. We look at it and I suppose we see Gothic horror and tropes of horror films and Twilight perhaps, but for them it was something that was new. If you look at Christian art in the Catholic period, it's full of stories and people and stuff. What he's doing as a good Lutheran is trying to look in nature and finding evidence of the sublime, evidence of God, by looking into the book of nature, as Calvin would have put it, and reading in the book of nature evidence of the presence and the purposes of God, and that would have been a new thing.
Friedrich uses the power of nature to heighten the drama of his picture. In winter, in the face of this barren, unforgiving scene, we feel the need for solace more than ever.
I mean, to a Christian, God in winter comes as no surprise, because the incarnation, the birth of Jesus, is something that happens not you know, in bright sunshine and not in a fanfare and blaze of glory, but somewhere very unexpected, the back of beyond, in the darkness of night, in winter, and the birth of a baby in a manger. That's become so familiar to us, we forget sometimes how surprising it is. But I think there's something of that surprise, the sheer counterintuitiveness of it, that Friedrich tries to capture. At the heart of Christianity is Christ crucified, abandoned on the cross, who cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Which is a cry which the world would seem to take up in the dead of winter, when the earth stands hard as iron, and it's cold, and it's wretched, and it's miserable. And that's that sense in Friedrich. He doesn't underestimate that at all. He doesn't gloss the darkness and the fierceness and the cold, but he never loses grip on the hope that's implicit in it too. It's very subtle.
The subtlety of Friedrich's Gothic imagination would ultimately see his powerful imagery become the stock-in-trade of the horror movie. But his popularity has been very variable. Though this painting had been bought by the King of Prussia, by the time of his death, he was largely forgotten.
Friedrich was revived in the early 20th century, specifically by German expressionist filmmakers who directly take their ideas from Friedrich. Now, this is interesting because Friedrich's painting, of course, comes straight after a terrible German defeat by Napoleon. And in the same way, the same anxiety, the same introspection comes straight after the First World War with the rise of German expressionist cinema. You can see this in films like Dr. Caligari, which deals specifically with mental illness, and with Nosferatu, which deals with the invasion of a foreign plague-ridden vampire into the midst of a German town.
The cinematic drama of Friedrich's dark winter landscapes was a somber Germanic response to the Napoleonic Wars. But for his restless British contemporary Joseph Turner, the fighting was merely an irritating inconvenience that prevented him from travelling to the continent. In 1802, he managed a brief visit to Switzerland during a lull in the conflict, but he was still using the sketches as inspiration 8 years later when he painted this view of an avalanche in the Alps.
He's a painter's painter. You could almost say that Caspar David Friedrich, his great German contemporary, is a photographer's painter. He has a kind of stillness which appeals very much to people now. But Turner is about what painting can do, what oil paint can do. This is paint making a world and then smashing that world and then stirring it about and then loving the results. Winter, avalanche, snow, blizzards, these massive forces give Turner the opportunity to depict abstract energy and abstract colour. If you wanted to depict the kind of abstract mystery of blinding whiteness, snow was the opportunity to do so. Bruegel saw that in the 16th century, and Turner sees it again. Snow for him is an opportunity to blast apart the conventions of realism.
The British liked their conventions, though, and took some persuading to see mountains in a new light. The Alps were generally regarded as something rather unpleasant and dangerous to hurry through on your way to more congenial pleasures further south. The philosopher, Bishop Berkeley, put up the shutters on his coach with a shudder as they hove into view. Turner, the son of a London barber who grew up in Covent Garden, was struck dumb by their majesty. But their effect on his great friend and champion, John Ruskin, was akin to a divine revelation. And it was his love of mountains that would bring about a profound change in our attitude to the whole idea of what winter was good for.
Ruskin was first brought here by his parents when he was about 14 years old in 1833, and the experience, is only fair to say, was religious. He felt that seeing something this beautiful, this astonishing, was absolute proof positive that there was a benevolent God. Now, Ruskin we remember as an art critic, but long before he became interested in painting, he was fascinated by geology. Had he not become an art critic, he would probably have become England's greatest geologist. And long before the problems that are raised by Darwin with biological difficulties with Genesis, in fact, geology was the science which really started to inflict the wounds much earlier than Darwin. And Ruskin says that every time he reads his Bible nowadays, he hears the chink of the geologist's hammers at the end of every cadence. And it's as though there's a literal undermining of his faith by these people with their little pickaxes. So geology at once leads him to God and leads him away from God. It's a really fascinating paradox.
Above the town of Chamonix, on the slopes of Mont Blanc, Ruskin faithfully recorded the progress of the Mer de Glace glacier.
It's really amazing to look at this because Ruskin, though he didn't give himself any great airs as an artist, was very precise. And if you look at the upper part of this engraving, you see the skyline is absolutely identical. You know, every little chip, every little spur, every little needle, exactly the same. But then if you come down and look at the lower half of the picture, it's completely changed. It's dropped 150 meters.
While Ruskin the artist painted the valley, Ruskin the scientist, an early enthusiast for the new medium of photography, made this daguerreotype image of the scene. But for the local population, whichever way you looked at it, the glacier was a malevolent thing.
I think we tend to think about glaciers as being relatively static, relatively immobile, but in fact, this particular gigantic flow of ice 1 year advanced by as much as 450 metres, eating into local farmlands, destroying local livelihoods. There was a cartoon done at the time of the glacier as a kind of voracious white dragon eating its way down through the hills with its wings spread out behind it, wings of snow. Ruskin would have loved that. For him, dragons encapsulated everything that was evil. And in fact, this whole area used to be known as the Cursed Mountain, the Mont Maudit. Bishops used to have to come and sprinkle holy water over it to diffuse the evil spirits. So by loving this place so much, by saying that it's actually not a place of evil but a place of beauty, Ruskin was really going against a very substantial folk tradition in the area.
The farmers of Chamonix were never going to love the glacier as Ruskin did, but he won an increasingly adoring following back home in Britain. His passion for this landscape was so infectious that almost single-handedly, he started the fashion for winter tourism.
Ruskin has to be held culpable for developments that would have made him weep. With all due respect to the people who come here for their vacations, that's fine, but had Ruskin seen the ski lifts, had he seen the cafes, had he seen all the attendant paraphernalia, I'm afraid he would have broken into tears.
Another of Ruskin's favourite views is on the other side of the valley. Today, the ski lift cuts short what, for Ruskin, would have been a quite considerable expedition, climbing several thousand feet above the town.
This view across Chamonix, what used to be called the Waterfall of Madness, Cascade de la Folie, was a scene he was particularly fond of. It's a very fine piece of work, and of course it's charged with Ruskin's notion that this is as close as you can get, almost literally, to paradise on Earth. Ruskin is a late romantic, which is one way of saying that he learned to find beautiful things that previous generations had found completely ugly. Snow, for example, in some ways his love of snow is an extension of his love of geology in general and of precious stones in particular. It's as though the mountainsides around us were simply cascaded with beautiful white jewellery. But of course, no one before Ruskin would have seen it that way. This was all completely new to people as an aesthetic idea, but Ruskin was so trusted that they followed his example. I mean, it's almost impossible to exaggerate quite how much faith the broad Victorian educated public put in Ruskin. He has almost no counterpart in the modern world. You have to combine David Attenborough with Terence Conran with Jamie Oliver or whatever. And none of them put together had quite the sway over the British public and were held in quite such affection and respect.
Like Bruegel, Ruskin used his art to completely change the way people thought about winter. The precision of his draftsmanship tamed the Alps and made them seem accessible. He established the idea that winter was something you could visit for a holiday. But his obsessive pursuit of accuracy was about to be turned on its head by a group of young Frenchmen who admired Turner as much as he did, but for all the wrong reasons. In their own way, the Impressionists were just as keen on accuracy and were obsessive about something they called snow effect, the elusive colour of the shadows in a snowy landscape. This is Monet's first stab at snow effect, painted in Honfleur in 1867.
As paintings, I personally think Monet's snow scenes are the best since Bruegel. He's a painter of light, he's a painter of transitory effects, impressions. He is not interested in sort of underlying realities of things. He's interested in what it looks like right now before my eyes, as it changes. And it's that sense of the passing world. The effect of light on snow, these incredibly light, sensitive, graceful capturings of passing moments. This is what Monet's about.
The notoriety of the early Impressionist exhibitions did not immediately lead to financial security for Monet. In 1878, poverty forced him to move to a rented house shared with another family in the village of Vétoy on the banks of the Seine, 40 miles from Paris. Soon after the family moved to the village, Monet's wife, Camille, became seriously ill. And after the birth of their second child, her condition deteriorated. He was often forced to choose between paint or medicine for his wife. In a letter, he said, "I haven't been able to work for a month now, lacking all colours."
When you know what Monet was going through in his life at the time, it makes you feel really differently about this painting. Monet is in the winter of his life, so it's fairly apt that it's so snowy. It's that bit where snow has gone from being really beautiful to being just like junky and dirty. It's not pristine snow, it's not about smoothness and purity and everything looking peaceful and sort of out of control a little bit. I suppose that's probably how he felt at the time, out of control. What you can see here are people. You don't see it at first because they're almost completely engulfed in the landscape, but they're more like ghosts. And I think that's incredibly poignant, as what's about to happen is that he will lose Camille and she'll become a ghost.
Camille died in September 1879. Some 40 years later, Monet described to a friend the thoughts that went through his mind as he sat next to their bed looking at her corpse. "I caught myself in the act of mechanically analysing the succession of appropriate colour gradations which death was imposing on her immobile face. Tones of blue, of yellow, of grey. Even before I had the idea of setting down the features to which I was so deeply attached, my organism automatically reacted to the colour stimuli, and my reflexes caught me up, in spite of myself, in an unconscious operation which was the daily course of my life." In this painting, she seems to be cocooned in ice.
This is such a tragic picture of Camille. It might seem macabre that he was painting her on her deathbed, but actually, it's completely what you have to do, what he had to do. It was compulsion to cherish her and treasure her, and I guess to not lose her completely, trying to capture her in the brush strokes and stroking her, because every single mark is that brush and that's a caress. And it's this kind of terrible, painful moment, and the only way that he could have got through it is painting.
Camille's death was followed by a brutally severe winter. On the 10th of December, the temperature reached a record low of minus 25 degrees. The Seine froze over completely, but by the thaw, Monet had managed to sell some of his winter landscapes of the village and was busy painting the vast blocks of ice as they broke up and drifted downstream. His time in Vétoy was to prove the turning point in Monet's life. He gained confidence, raised his prices, and his career began to prosper. Financial success for the French Impressionists was cemented by an exhibition that took place in 1886 and featured over 40 of Monet's paintings. But it didn't happen in Paris or London, it happened in New York. After suffering years of critical scorn at home, the Impressionists were immensely successful on the other side of the Atlantic. Monet's dealer, Paul Durand Ruel, said, "The American public does not laugh, it buys." In a great cultural exchange, many American painters traveled to Paris to learn about Impressionism firsthand. Amongst them was the man who was to become the preeminent American Impressionist, Childe Hassam. The man who will go down to posterity is the man who paints his own time and the scenes of everyday life around him, said Hassam. And there was certainly lots going on to paint. New York was just beginning to emerge as one of the world's great cities, with its own distinct style and culture, and needed its own artists to recognize its changing status. Hassam loved snow and painted it wherever he was. He made this picture in his native Boston. Like Monet, Hassam wanted to paint the elements as he saw them in front of him at that moment, and was equally fascinated by the winter light. But his most enduring images of winter are of New York. This picture shows horse-drawn cabs struggling down Fifth Avenue. For Hassam, capturing winter in New York wasn't a question of getting out in the sunshine and exploring the snow effect in the shadows. He wanted to paint the blur of driving snow in the teeth of the storm. During that same winter, on the same street, a similar scene was created by another man who saw himself as an artist, but he was using a camera. This image is probably the world's first successful photograph of falling snow. Alfred Stieglitz was born in New York, but spent 10 years as a young man in Europe. When he returned to his native Manhattan, he was fired with enthusiasm for photography, convinced it was the art form of the future. At a time when serious photography required a bulky plate camera, Stieglitz purchased a smaller 4x5-inch model and began to photograph life on the streets of New York. His return to the city coincided with a run of terrible winters, and many of his most famous pictures are scenes of Manhattan in the snow, like this photograph, The Terminal.
Winter in New York is brutal. It is absolutely brutal. But what really happens in New York in the winter is life slows down. People stay inside as much as possible. So I imagine that Stieglitz had, he had a lot of fun walking around the city and kind of seeing seeing it laid bare a little bit more. Just like leaves fall off trees and you get to see the skeletons of the trees, you get to see kind of the inner workings of the city a little bit more because there's less life on the street. In this picture, you can see the curve of the tracks where the streetcars made their turn before going back north up to Harlem. And actually, this bus right behind me is following almost exactly that same curve as it too turns around to go north. This picture is a window into the past. It's a glimpse into New York at a moment when it was changing incredibly rapidly. The 1890s was really the period where New York went from a local city to being a world capital. It was winter that drove those changes and really forced the city to become what it is today.
Like the enlightened Scots 100 years earlier, 19th century New Yorkers felt secure in their modern city, immune to the perils of the natural world. But winter likes to remind us of our frailty from time to time. The Great White Hurricane, a blizzard that hit the city on the night of the 12th of March, 1888, killed 200 people, and almost every form of infrastructure failed. The city was left paralyzed, with no functioning transport or communication.
by the end of the 19th century, Lower Manhattan was turning into a financial capital of the world, and it relied on communication, telegraph and telephone wires, and then soon after, electrical wires as well. When they had a hard winter, like during the blizzard of 88, ice would form on those wires and the weight would cause the poles to come down or the wires to snap. That made the city really decide to start enforcing the rules that were already on the books, that the utility companies had to put these wires underground. And you can see from these two pictures the drastic difference that made, right? It cleared out the street, which isn't very clear these days, but for a while it cleared out the streetscape.
For Stieglitz, there was no question what made the streetscape look best. Whenever it snowed, he would set out with his camera to capture New York transformed. He photographed the birth of the city we recognize today, like this view of the Flatiron Building in the snow at the dawn of the skyscraper age. Always experimenting, he dramatically cropped this picture to emphasize the building's verticality. It appeared to be moving toward me like the bow of a monster steamer, Stieglitz said. A picture of a new America still in the making. As a prodigal son of New York, he returned to the city with a European modernist's eye. This picture, City of Ambition, helped to establish the Manhattan skyline as a futurist utopian icon. But the street plan still betrays the original landscape it was built on.
There's a clue about what used to be here in the name, Canal Street. It used to be a canal that drained Lower Manhattan. Now, drainage ditch is still here. It's today a sewer, and it was actually New York's very first covered sewer. When you get a big snowfall, for example, and all of that snow melts and you don't want it flooding the streets, that has to go out to the rivers.
Steve describes himself as a guerrilla historian, and his explorations of lost urban infrastructure are not always done with permission from the relevant authorities.
So I try not to have an audience sometimes when I do this, because they wouldn't always understand. And to my mind, what's really cool is that when you go underground, you can go into the past. You can see how the city used to be. Still flowing.
Even today, blizzards can threaten loss of life. But centrally heated urban environments insulate us from the harsh reality of extreme climate events and from the patterns of the year. At the end of the 19th century, the population balance shifted rapidly. More and more people became city dwellers and sought to remove the possibility that climate could interfere with commerce. Winter seemed irksome at worst, and as the last snow melted away, the fatal power of the cold was forgotten. In pursuit of the elusive connection to the seasonal rhythms, the Italian painter Giovanni Segantini left the industrial city of Milan, where he had grown up, for the more extreme climate of the Alps. Painting in the mountains above the Swiss town of St. Moritz, he rediscovered the power of winter as a metaphor for death. Housed in a museum dedicated to his work, the triptych Life, Nature and Death showed landscapes from the local Engadine Valley. Death is a winter dawn.
Giovanni Segantini, he was really attracted to winter because it was such an extreme season for him. The white of the snow fascinated him. And it really played also with the lights and the colors, because the reflections in winter are so much stronger. So for him, it was just something magic. You can basically feel the crispy air in his paintings.
That Segantini became a painter at all was something of a miracle.
He lost his mother when he was only 5 years old, and his father took him to a, a sister in Milan, and there he had a very gruesome and difficult childhood. He was actually a street kid. He didn't feel comfortable in a big town like Milan, so he was looking for nature. He just wanted to go higher up, and that was towards the light, towards the mountains.
The picture shows a family group watching as two undertakers carry a body to a waiting horse-drawn sled. Above the mountains hovers a large billowing cloud, glowing in the dawn sunlight. His art took the physical reality of winter and gave it a strongly metaphorical form, romantic and mysterious, but always rooted in the landscape.
I think he chose to represent death in winter because it's such a brutal and almost cruel season. He wanted to show the grandiosity of the mountains, of nature, that would overcome the pain of the loss of this child. I would say the direction of the horse, that it would carry the child, the dead child, towards the light. So there is some sort of hope after death.
Segantini would take his vast canvases to his subject and work in the open, constructing a temporary wooden shelter if the weather turned against him. He became immensely successful in his lifetime, with works exhibited all over Europe. But his mother gave up Austrian citizenship whilst admitting to replace it with anything else. Stateless, Segantini was unable to leave Switzerland.
He was a very solitary soul and he wasn't able to travel. So his only choice and passion was actually to stay in his mountains and try to get the beauty and the light, this very, very special light. And that was actually the quest of his life and his painting, to really show the world the beautiful magic light of the Engadin and the mountains.
Whilst working to finish this picture, he spent long hours at high altitude in the mountains. The strain weakened him. He developed peritonitis and died in his painting hut overlooking the Engadin Valley that he loved. He was 41.
You wanna make me wanna shout, take my hand, let's shout, for my hand, let's shout, come on.
In Samaritz today, it's difficult to see winter as a metaphor for death. In temperatures of minus 20 degrees, the frozen lake becomes a horse racing track to stage the White Turf Festival and its accompanying party. These revelers, like the Londoners on Hondius's frozen Thames or the Venetians at their carnival, are perfectly happy out in the cold. But this cavalier attitude to the temperature requires the certainty of a refuge from the cold. For the homeless, winter was still a killer. In the rapidly expanding city of New York, a group of artists, later known as the Ashcan School, gave winter an urban setting every bit as uncompromising as Segantini's portrayal of death. On the margins of society, the bums of Manhattan, the subject of this picture by George Bellows, were still vulnerable to the cruelty of a bitter winter.
What I love about this picture is Bellows really captures the eternal New York story, which is out with the old and in with the new. The Queensboro Bridge, which we're standing under, hasn't even opened yet. It's about to open in, I'm going to say, 3 or 4 months. This is probably early 1909, and the bridge opens in May. And the bridge signifies new New York. The city is expanding and growing, and the subways are only about 5 years old. But these are all tremendous changes in the city. And these men have no place in it. These men are pushed under the bridge. Othello's is telling us they're New York's refuse, they're New York's trash.
The Ashcan painters saw themselves in opposition to the whimsical impressionism of Childe Hassam and had more in common with the documentary photography of Stieglitz. Winter was a frequent subject for both, but for Bellows especially, his art had a powerful social conscience.
And I think Winter underscores the rawness and the cruelty. This isn't like fluffy, wonderful snow that, you know, you're playing in or that's exciting and beautiful. This is a raw scene. This is that cold March day where the wind is coming off the river. They're huddled by a fire, but it doesn't matter. You know in their bones that they are cold. And if they have a torn boot, you know, their feet are wet. They feel it. This was a whole neighborhood of tanneries and breweries and slaughterhouses. I mean, it was a pretty filthy, disgusting place. You can just imagine how bad it smelled. Nobody in New York City wanted to live near the rivers. That's why Fifth Avenue became such a posh street at the time. It's the center of the island of Manhattan. It's as far away from this as you can get.
The aim of the Ashcan School was to celebrate an urban vitality, capturing spontaneous moments of everyday life. But Bellows was also keen to document the rapid change in New York, and he knew that both the tenement building and the men huddled in its shadow would soon be swept away by the expanding city.
Well, the light is brilliant, and what's interesting about the painting is that at the top of the tenement and at the bridge in the sky, the light is very redemptive. You can imagine the people who are on the bridge or who will be on the bridge in a few months going across in this great, grand new city. You know, everything's light and beautiful and promising. And underneath it, where nobody can see, these men are swept under the bridge, literally swept into the shadows of New York City.
Another Ashcan painter with a romantic love for New York was John Sloane. The great thing about painting the city, he said, was that landmarks are torn down so rapidly that your canvases become historical records almost before the paint on them is dry. Sloane loved winter. He caught perfectly the impersonal and solitary nature of urban life. And by setting his subjects in winter, he gave them another reason not to linger on their journey, hurrying home to the warm. He recorded the last days of the L trains, the elevated tracks that had failed in the blizzard of 1888 and had been rendered redundant by the subway. Sloane was fascinated by European movements like Cubism and struck up a friendship with the pioneer of conceptual art, Marcel Duchamp. On a bitter winter night in January 1917, Sloane, Duchamp, and several friends broke into the Washington Arch in the artistic ghetto of Greenwich Village. It was snowing lightly, and the Arch Conspirators, as they called themselves, decorated the roof with balloons and huddled in blankets, drinking tea and moonshine and letting off cap guns.
By having this party in what was supposed to be a serious monument built by the city, they were making a claim on public space.
The event did have a serious purpose. The United States was on the verge of committing troops to the First World War, and the arch conspirators read a proclamation declaring the establishment of the free and independent Republic of Greenwich Village.
There was a lot of fear at the time about saboteurs, especially about potential anarchists. The same thing has been happening since September 11th. Today it's terrorists. Back then it was anarchists. The fear is actually similar, and the way that the city reacts to people who want to try to make the city their own is often the same. I see similarities with the way that Sloane and his peers were painting at the time. The Ashcan School of Painting took really the existing landscape of the city and celebrated it. Things that seemed kind of banal So I love that. I think they were doing the same thing with this party. They were taking this existing structure and making it into their own, making it something fun. I've always liked this thing a lot more, knowing that in 1917, these crazy artists had a party all night at the top. I wish I could have joined them.
The Declaration of Independence must surely have been written by Duchamp, consisting as it did solely of the repetition of the word whereas.
Whereas, 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 we declare free and independent Republic of Greenwich Village.
The independent Republic of Greenwich Village failed to prevent the United States from entering the Great War. Napoleon had abolished winter breaks in wartime, and there was no let-up in the slaughter on the Western Front. The Battle of Cambrai in November 1917 saw the first use of large numbers of tanks by the Allies. But after a brief period of spectacular success, the advance was checked. The Germans retook most of the territory, and by the end of November, things were back where they started. Then it began to snow. The German front line ran just to the north of the hamlet of La Vacquerie, with the British trenches the other side of an area of high ground known as the Welsh Ridge. On the 30th of December, the Germans launched a surprise attack, turning winter to their advantage.
The snow was 2-3 feet deep. Everything was white. And just before dawn, in the midst of a freezing fog, they came over this slope, all dressed in white camouflage. And they were immensely successful. And later that day, the British decided to try and launch a kind of counterattack. And this painting depicts the moment when that regiment was ordered to go over the top.
Though later employed as a war artist, on this day, John Nash was a serving soldier fighting in the Artists' Rifles Battalion.
You can see from the painting that these guys didn't stand a chance, because everything here was white. Everything in the painting is white. Snow white, white clouds, white mist, white surface. And what are they wearing? They're wearing dark brown greatcoats. So the German gunners just picked them off. 80 men went over the top, and within just a few minutes, 68 of them had been killed. And fortunately, one of the dozen men to escape unscathed was John Nash, who painted this picture. And I think one of the reasons he survived was just before he went over the top, he took off his greatcoat because he thought it was too conspicuous. He thought it was too dark in colour, and he wore a pale tunic instead. And that probably saved his life. And this painting I just found incredibly powerful because it's so matter of fact. You know, there's no sentimentality in it whatsoever. And it's the body language of these men in the row. They're just sort of glumly trudging through the snow up this hill towards what they know will be death. I mean, these guys haven't even got out of the trench with their lives. Other people have died the moment they've got out. This guy here has just been shot and he's fallen down to his knees. Nash hated painting figures. He couldn't paint figures very well, but he knew he had to do it with this painting because it was so important. He thought that what happened on these slopes was murder, pure and simple.
Like so many other actions of this conflict, the attack Nash painted was largely pointless. No progress was made by the sacrifice of the lives of his comrades, and the few yards of mud over which they fought remained a part of no man's land.
When most people think about the First World War, what do they think of? Well, they think of mud, and they think of rain, and they think of lifeless landscapes, trees without leaves. They think of long nights and freezing soldiers. What they're thinking about is winter. That was what the First World War was. It was a really long, brutal, murderous winter. But it wasn't a natural winter. It was a winter that we manufactured.
This man-made misery inspired Nash's contemporary, the young futurist painter Richard Nevinson, to produce his greatest works. La Mitrailleuse combined his fascination for machinery with a horror at the brutality of conflict. It was described by Walter Sickert as the most authoritative and concentrated utterance on war in the history of painting. Nevinson, the son of campaigning liberal parents, was a pacifist and worked in the trenches as an ambulance driver. After the war, he continued to use his art as a platform for social commentary, but in order to reach a wider audience, he became a regular columnist for the Daily Mail and the Daily Express, becoming more curmudgeonly as he grew older. One of his pet hates was football. He had been a profoundly unhappy schoolboy, sent away to boarding school at Uppingham to allow his mother and father more time to concentrate on their various causes. And he associated winter with compulsory organized sport. The misery of afternoons on the football field was still fresh in his mind when he painted this picture in 1930 at the age of 41.
Nevinson would be horrified by the idea that this painting would now be being used to promote football in any way. He despised all sports. Right from when he was at Uppingham School and he was bullied, he considered that sport was something for brutes, basically. Nevinson was very much associated with the Italian futurists, and in the Italian Futurist Manifesto, they included sport as something that they felt was really important to put right at the heart of culture. And Nevinson did put sport within his art, but he put it within his art to show us what a waste of time it was.
Nevinson never indicated the location of any wintry afternoon, but the dark satanic mills that form its background are always assumed to be in Manchester, a part of the country he had rarely visited, and for which he had a stereotypical southerner's contempt.
This painting really shows that Nevinson thought it truly was grim up north. The closer you look at this painting, the more of that you see, whether it's in the gasometer in the background, the train, the steam coming off it, the darkness, the thunderclouds, the rain. Football had previously been seen very much as a northerner's game. No London club had won the league up until this point, and there's always been great discussion about whether the football teams in the painting are Manchester United and Manchester City or not. And Nevinson was furious at the idea that anyone should even be discussing this. And you can see the tops are red and the socks are blue. He doesn't care. He's not trying to say, this is a particular player, this is a particular team. He would say, well, you know, that's not the point. The point is, stop watching football. It's often said that the Premiership era is the first time where there's really been a major tension between the money that is in the game and the fans of the game. But actually, a very similar thing was happening in the 1920s. This was the time when the first £10,000 footballer had just been sold. The clubs were turning into businesses, and Nevinson wrote extensively about this in his very provocative columns in the Mail and the Express at the time, you know, openly hostile to what this was doing to our culture. This painting goes to show that really he thought that sport was the opium of the masses, and he wanted the masses to stop taking opium and to go and do something else instead that was a lot more cultured.
Nevinson's vision of winter is a far cry from Bruegel's. 400 years after the hunters struggle for survival in the snow, Nevinson's equally abject figures are merely struggling to win a football match. Had winter finally given up the fight? During the 1930s, winters were noticeably milder. Scotland experienced an almost complete absence of significant snowfall in the winter of 1931. The Reverend Walker's skates would have stayed in the cupboard. For the first time, scientists began to express concern that the world was warming up. The US Weather Bureau concluded in a survey in 1934 that the winters were indeed colder and the snow deeper when Grandad was a lad. But winter wasn't giving up yet. The euphoria that followed victory in the Second World War was short-lived. Rationing continued, and there was a sense that things weren't really working out for Britain in the post-war world. In January 1947, the country was plunged into the most severe winter of the century.
Don't know why,
There's no sun up in the sky, stormy weather.
Power stations closed down for lack of coal, and even the Houses of Parliament operated by candlelight. The magazine Picture Post published a special edition on the crisis and chose a dramatic image by the photographer Bill Brandt for the cover.
Oh, yeah, life is bare. Gloom and misery everywhere. Stormy weather, stormy weather.
This was one of the great notorious winters in my lifetime, 1947. I was only a 12-year-old boy in that winter. I thought it was great fun, but it was a wicked winter. What this picture is the suffering of stones in silence. During 1947, there wouldn't have been the constant stream and flow of traffic. That kind of traffic didn't exist. So this would have been a total wilderness here.
This atmospheric picture was not the sort of thing Picture Post would usually have used for a cover image.
When you were talking about one of the most dramatic winters for many generations, you could have used something much more symbolic, like the struggle of a human being, you know, trying to keep themselves warm and safe from this atrocious winter. But they chose to use this poetic image of Stonehenge. I mean, there's nobody in it, nothing in it. I'm sure that Bill Brandt persuaded the editor to go in another direction. This is not the kind of thing that Picture Post was known for.
It's such an epic photograph, captioned Where Stands Britain. It's a monumental proposition here. What does this country stand for? Who are we? And so Brandt's picture is waiting for the spirit of the nation to come rising up in some way. And what does he use to depict the spirit of the nation but, you know, Stonehenge, our most ancient monument? This is a going back to first principles. This is thinking about our very first identity and what we might want now. What are we going to build over the desolation of war? And so what Brandt is brilliant at doing is looking at the material reality of Britain and making it speak. His pictures talk. This very stark, very monumental photograph of Stonehenge seems just pausing, waiting for the kind of dialogue of modern Britain to start.
This was published as a sort of state of the nation picture, but actually, I mean, it's a piece of abstract art. The way Stonehenge divides the picture in two, you have the whiteness below it and then that exploding apocalyptic sky above. But in that sense of three layers, makes me think of Mark Rothko's abstract paintings of exactly the same time, when he was painting vertical abstractions which are divided into sort of three layers of colour. And here, Brandt has managed to do that in a photograph.
Brandt began his career in Paris in 1929 and worked for a while as a studio assistant to Man Ray.
The thing about Bill Brandt was that really deep down, I think he considered himself to be an artist much more than a photographer. Bill used to print his own pictures and inject a huge amount of drama and blackness and darkness. And that was his hallmark. Everybody knew a Brandt print when they saw it, but this is much more tender. Bill Brandt was quite notorious for posing up or creating things that are not totally the truth, but there's nothing deceitful about this. It's haunting in a way.
Having made his reputation as a war photographer in some of the world's most inhospitable places, Don McCullin is now concentrating on landscapes, but his love of winter still makes it an uncomfortable calling.
I see the winter time as my moment of drama. I spend hours standing in waterlogged fields, watching the light. I love the nakedness, and I love the harshness of the light, the drama of the light, which we've seen today here, the skies, the sun going down early in the afternoon. You know, our afternoons in the winter, they don't last very long. But for me, that's the magical hour when I can be alone in a field somewhere. I don't mind standing for 2 or 3 hours in the same place, knowing if I stick it out, I'm going to get what I want. It has to be remembered that I looked at Bill Brandt's pictures as a young photographer before I could call myself a photographer. I took a lot of my disciplines from his composition. Always felt sometimes that I was stealing his eye as well, but nevertheless, I owe him a great deal.
Every picture that we're looking at here is a kind of dialogue with the elements. Art itself is a kind of defense mechanism, because if you can paint cold and snow, you're exercising a kind of command over nature. You're trapping it within a frame and coming to understand it. And I think we've used art across the centuries as a way of coping, as a kind of extra coat that we put on. The more that we can understand winter, the better equipped we are to get through it.
Human beings, I think, have a habit of painting the things that they're most scared of. And for so much of history, we were terrified of the winter. And I think that's why we kept coming back to it. We felt that by painting it, by somehow putting it down on canvas, we were controlling it. We were coming to terms with it. We were understanding it. And I think that's why winter inspired some of our most powerful and beautiful artworks.
Today, our relationship to winter is ambivalent. The terror has gone. If the weather is not forthcoming, we can create our own winter wonderland and skate on the ice in the centre of London as if the Thames had frozen once more. The seasonal shopping frenzy builds towards Christmas and leaves us with a drawn-out battle of endurance as the grey light and short days drag towards the promise of spring. But the images of winter that art has left us for consolation can still evoke that elemental sense of awe we felt when the hunters set out in the snow.